I am going to speak to you today about the issue of raising defenses to the admissibility of business records in debt buyers cases in Maine's district and superior courts. In other places in our advocate library, in other classroom modules, we have discussed the issue of defending a third-party debt buyer case or defending against a third-party debt buyer case in small claims court. There are many reasons why a creditor may bring a case in small claims court, one of which is the issue of the rules of evidence not applying in small claims court. Now, there are many other defenses available to you, but one defense you do not have necessarily available to you is the business records defense when a creditor, a third-party debt buyer, attempts to introduce into evidence documents that are allegedly kept in the regular course of business. In Maine's district and superior courts, the rules of evidence, of course, apply, and the relevant rule of evidence, the Maine rule of evidence that's a hearsay exception, rule 803, subsection 6, addresses the issue of the admissibility of business records. Simply put, if documents sought to be admitted are not authenticated by a qualified witness under that rule, they are not admissible. This issue comes up, of course, at trial, but it also is an issue, and many of the same arguments apply, when one is defending a motion for summary judgment. The reason for that is, in Maine's summary judgment rules, Rule 56E says that affidavits supporting statements of material fact can only contain facts that would be admissible in evidence. So for purposes of this discussion today, the same information I'm going to present applies both when you're cross-examining so-called qualified witness attempting to introduce business records, or when you're writing your brief in opposition to a motion for summary judgment, when those same records are being sought to be the basis for the motion for summary judgment so the creditor can claim judgment against you. The examples of records that we see in these cases that we seek, for obvious reasons, to keep out of evidence are records of the account itself and records of any assignment from the original creditor to the third-party debt buyer who's the plaintiff in your case. There are a number of main cases from our law court that address the issue of the admissibility of business records in these third-party either debt buyer cases or cases involving foreclosure of real estate, which in fact have many of the same issues raised. To admit a business record pursuant to Rule 803-6 in the state of Maine, the party offering evidence must lay a proper foundation by being a qualified witness. Case law in Maine has addressed this issue in cases such as, but not limited to, Beneficial Maine versus Carter, Arrow Financial versus Giuliani, Catch versus Kulas, and HSBC Mortgage Services versus Murphy. Those cases addressed the issue of the admissibility of business records and define qualified witness in ways that help us understand the Rule 803-6. In order to lay that proper foundation, the custodian or qualified witness must show that the record in issue, the record that they're seeking to admit, was made at or near the time of events reflected in the record by or from information transmitted by a person with personal knowledge of the events recorded therein. Two, the record must have been kept in the regular course of regularly conducted business. Three, that it was the regular practice of the business to make records of the type involved. And four, that no lack of trustworthiness is indicated from the source of information from which the record was made or the method or circumstances under which the record was prepared. Now that's a citation of case law that's common really throughout the cases that I just cited to you. When we go to court, we find that debt buyers oftentimes will seek to introduce evidence under the affidavit of a person purporting to be a records keeper. But when you read closely the affidavit, you'll see that a number of statements made in the affidavit show or indicate that the person is very likely not a qualified witness or custodian of the records under the case law that I just cited and under Maine Rule of Evidence 803. Oftentimes, the affiant will indicate that he or she is a legal liaison or legal specialist. That is not a records keeper by definition. That is a person who is hired to gather documents in preparation for litigation. And in the event you have the opportunity to cross-examine an individual claiming to be the records keeper but having the title of legal liaison or legal specialist, inquiry should be made into what that person does all day, every day, and you'll learn that it's very likely that that person goes to court. A person may also say in their affidavit that he or she has reviewed the records of either the original creditor or of the plaintiff, that he or she is familiar with the accounting processes of and the record-keeping practices of the original creditor and or the plaintiff. This does not reflect that this person has an intimate knowledge, something that is required, an intimate knowledge of the operations of either the original creditor or the plaintiff in the case. And recall, the case law indicates and the rule requires that this person has to have personal knowledge about the record being made at or near the time of the events reflected, that they have to know that the record was kept in the regular course of business. They have to know about the regular practices of the businesses. And many times these affidavits are woefully inadequate on these counts. The issue of third-party debt buyers compounds the problem for these affiants also because they inevitably are either only employees of the plaintiff, or they may not even be employees of the plaintiff, but instead be a servicer of the debt for the plaintiff. These, at every opportunity that the person's involvement, the purported records keeper, is removed from the keeping of the original records, the stronger the defense case gets to show that this person could not have the requisite knowledge to be a records keeper under the Maine, the very strict requirements of Maine Rule 803. The case of Beneficial Maine versus Carter discusses the issue of the servicer and how the servicer has to have, and I'll read from the case, in such instances, records will be admissible pursuant to the business records exception to the hearsay rule if the foundational evidence from the receiving entity's employee is adequate to demonstrate that the employee had sufficient knowledge of both businesses' regular practices to demonstrate the reliability and trustworthiness of the information. Now, that case goes on to set forth criteria to show the requirement that the affiant has to show, demonstrate knowledge, that the producer of the record at issue employed regular business practices for creating and maintaining the records that were sufficiently accepted by the receiving business to allow reliance on the records by the receiving business, that the producer of the record at issue employed regular business practices for transmitting them to the receiving business. By manual or electronic processes, the receiving business integrated the records into its own records and maintained them through regular business processes, and that the record at issue was, in fact, among the receiving business's own records, and the receiving business relied on these records in its day-to-day operations. Now, many of those requirements for an affiant to qualify as a records keeper, maybe for the receiving business, are barriers when the time comes to assess the affiant's claim that he or she knows about the records keeping practices of the original creditor. It is almost inevitably the case that one business records keeper of the plaintiff cannot show that both the originating creditor and the receiving entity kept their records in a particular way, and that the affiant has an intimate knowledge of how those records were kept. The other big issue that we see in these cases involves the business records surrounding the assignment of the debt from the original creditor to the plaintiff. And keep in mind, sometimes there are multiple assignments, so you can imagine that the difficulties that the purported records keeper has to meet the requirements of Maine Rule of Evidence 803 in a case involving one assignment are only compounded when there are multiple assignments. But in any event, we see these issues of assignment coming up where the affiant also seeks to prove in its claim that the records of the original creditor and of the servicer or the plaintiff are kept in the regular course of business, they also use that same affidavit and that same affiant to prove that the assignment occurred. Well, the records of assignment are business records, and in order to get those admitted, the affiant needs to lay the proper foundation as a qualified records keeper of those records as well. And here's where a lot of cases fall down. It is never usually pled by the affiant that the affiant keeps records of assignments or is aware of all the details, the fine details of the assignment, sufficient to have an intimate knowledge of the circumstances of the assignment. The records themselves in these assignments are often heavily redacted and are quite unclear about what was assigned, what the circumstances of the assignment were. The purchase and sale agreement between the original creditor and the plaintiff is usually never disclosed or provided, but it has important terms that that we defendants should learn about and know about. And the witness or the affiant is almost never capable or qualified to testify about those issues. Specifically, with the issue of redacted documents, many of these documents are redacted before they're provided with the pleadings, and thus that means that they're redacted for purposes of litigation. And if a document is prepared in anticipation of litigation, that is something quite different than saying it is kept in the regular course of business. And so if an affiant can't explain either, well, in the affidavit or at trial, what has been redacted and what the terms are that have been deleted or not provided, then certainly that person's not qualified to introduce evidence of the assignment. And if you can't introduce evidence of the assignment, then the plaintiff can't prove that it owns the debt. And so that's another great opportunity to defend in these cases. Overarching all of these analyses are requirements that the affiant or the person who's testifying as the so-called business records keeper has to be able to talk about or discuss the trustworthiness of the records. It's referenced in the case law. It's either implied or expressly stated in Rule 803.6. That's the reason why it is an exception to the hearsay rule, because the records themselves are so inherently trustworthy. And in these cases, with people who are legal liaisons, not true records keepers, not possessing the intimate knowledge of the workings of the original creditor or the account itself or the plaintiff, not knowing about the assignment. In these cases, it's an insurmountable barrier for most of these affiants or most of these witnesses at trial to show that the evidence is trustworthy and thus warranting admission without being challenged. And so for all of those reasons, it's very important to assess these affidavits and the records very, very carefully. You'll have plenty of opportunity to do so, of course, in anticipation of opposition of a motion for summary judgment at trial. You'll have plenty of opportunity to cross-examine witnesses in the unlikely event that the plaintiff third-party debt buyer brings a witness to court at trial. You'll have plenty of opportunity to challenge under the business records defense here.